for service in Cairncastle Presbyterian this morning. Whether you're in church, the lecture hall, or the McFerrin Hall, or even at home watching online, you're very welcome to join us in worship this morning. We extend also a very warm welcome to the Reverend Andrew Watson, along with his wife Hazel, this morning. As you will all know, this is a very special service, not only for us, but also for Mr. Watson, who is conducting our service this morning as sole nominee to fill our vacancy. And we wish him God's blessing as he brings God's message to us. Just a brief reminder for all our voting members, you will have received the necessary information and voting papers in the post last week, which have to be returned by noon on Monday the 2nd of November. That's tomorrow week. These can be posted directly to our convener, the Reverend Ian Carton. They can be left in the ballot box, which will be on the vestibule table next week. Or they can simply be dropped into the church post box, which is located on the wall just at the end of the building here, beside the assembly point. And if for some reason you haven't actually received your voting papers, please speak to me or to any of the elders and we'll sort that out for you. Finally, again, just to remind you about our COVID arrangements, face masks should now be worn throughout the service, and please remain in your seats until one of the stewards directs you to leave, so we can keep everyone as safe as possible. So those are all the announcements for this morning, and I'll hand over now to Mr. Watson.
Good morning, Cairncastle.
Good morning.
Good to see you. Lovely to be with you. Welcome to the folk in the hall as well, and those of you joining us live on Facebook from Cairncastle congregation, and also I think a few other friends around the country as well. It's good to be together in spirit, worshiping God. Let's worship the Lord together as we hear some words from Psalm 100. Sing to the Lord, all the world. Worship the Lord with joy. Come before him with happy songs. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us, and we belong to him. We are his people. We are his flock. Enter the temple gates with thanksgiving. Go into its courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise him. The Lord is good. His love is eternal, and his faithfulness lasts. Amen. May God bless his word to us here today. Let's pray together, shall we? Almighty God, gracious Father in heaven, what a pleasure, what a privilege is ours once more to gather into a meeting house to worship you. We thank you for the place and for all its associations and memories. We thank you for the people, our neighbors and friends, our fellowship. But we thank you too for your amazing grace through Jesus Christ, for it's in his name we come into your holy presence. There is a part of us that feels quite uncomfortable as we consider the things we have thought and said and done that have not been worthy of you, the things which your word tell us are clearly wrong. O Lord, we have sinned and fallen short. We need to be forgiven. But we come with thanks and praise to you for your wonderful grace in Christ. For the Son of God who came into this world and became one of us, who lived in a place a bit like this, who lived in a house a bit like ours, and rubbed shoulders with people just like us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you were willing to live here for a while and for your amazing ministry and for your death on the cross for our sins. That's what we're depending on. And so in Jesus' name, we ask that our sins might be forgiven, that our hearts and conscience might be cleansed, that we might be assured today of the welcome love of our Father in heaven, the assurance of the Holy Spirit that we are indeed children of God by faith through the grace of God. We thank you that grace first taught our hearts to fear. Grace our fears relieved. Grace has brought us safe this far. The grace of God will bring us safe home. So we trust in you, dear Lord, and we pray that you would speak to us again today from your word. As we read the scripture, may it encourage us and challenge us as always. May it lead us in the light of your truth, for Jesus' sake. Who taught his followers to pray like this, if you would like to join with me, we say the Lord's Prayer. Together we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We are going to read from the Old Testament prophet Isaiah, chapter 40. Let's listen carefully. This is the word. Comfort my people, says our God. Comfort them. Encourage the people of Jerusalem. Tell them they've suffered long enough and their sins are now forgiven. I have punished them in full for all their sins. A voice cries out, Prepare in the wilderness a road for the Lord. Clear the way in the desert for our God. Fill every valley. Level every mountain. The hills will become a plain, and the rough country will be made smooth. Then the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all mankind will see it. The Lord himself has promised this. A voice cries out, Proclaim a message. What message shall I proclaim, I ask? Proclaim that all mankind are like grass. They last no longer than wild flowers. Grass withers and flowers fade when the Lord sends the wind blowing over them. People are no more enduring than grass. Yes, grass withers and flowers fade. But the word of our God endures forever. Jerusalem, go up on a high mountain and proclaim the good news. Call out with a loud voice, Zion. Announce the good news. Speak out and do not be afraid. Tell the towns of Judah that their God is coming. The sovereign Lord is coming to rule with power, bringing with him the people he has rescued. He will take care of his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs together and carry them in his arms. He will gently lead their mother. Amen. May God bless his word to us here just now. Let's sing together, shall we? Now, unfortunately, you've got to keep those masks on. Sorry about that. And I think we're staying sitting down as well. But let's sing with no less fervor in our hearts to the Lord. The Lord's my shepherd. I love him.
Oh,
And I have a story for all the boys and girls between the ages of 1 and 97. So if you fall into that category, you're my Sunday school class just now, okay? You're all boys and girls. And so I need you to help me with this story. Now, Cairncastle, are you up for this?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Slightly better. Okay, I need help with this story because I need some sound effects. And I need you to make the sound of a snake. Some of you are clearly naturals at this. Very good. So every time in the story you hear the word snake, I want you to go. We're ready. Wee Josh doesn't live in Cairncastle. Wee Josh doesn't even live in Ireland, for a creator. He lives in Africa, in an African country, where there are lots and lots of different animals. You know, they've got hippopotami, and they've got rhinoceri, and they've got lions, and they've got elephants, and they've got gazelle, and they've got other things that I can't pronounce properly. And, you know, one of the things that they really have quite rather a lot of, snakes. Okay, that was an easy one. So, this particular day, little Joshua, he loves going to school, loves doing his lessons, and he was doing his homework in a favourite spot under the shade of a big tree, and he was there and he had his book and he had some crayons and he was doing some colouring and he was really enjoying that. He was concentrating on what he was doing and his daddy came home from work And Josh's daddy came home, and he came, just as daddies sometimes do, he came to see how Josh was doing. And so there was Josh with his book and his crayons, there was a big tree, a great big branch hanging out over Josh. What do you think? Coiled around the branches of that tree, there was a huge snake. And it wasn't just any old snake. It was the most poisonous snake in all Africa. And Josh's daddy knew that just one bite from that poisonous reptile, and Josh would die. There wouldn't be time to take him to hospital. They probably wouldn't have an antidote anyway. What did he do? So Josh's daddy said, Joshua, I need you to look at me. Joshua looked up at his dad. And his daddy said, I need you to do exactly what I say. I want you to leave your book and your crayons, and I need you to stand up very slowly. Now, if you were Josh, what would you be thinking? You'd be thinking, oh, Daddy, I'm going to chase yourself. I'm quite enjoying doing my homework here. You'd come back to me later, Joe. But Josh left his book and his crayons, and he stood up very slowly. Well, the snake, meanwhile, saw his lunch getting closer, and so he started to come slithering down the branch and get closer. Josh's daddy said, I'm going to count to three, and when I count to three, I want you to run as fast as you can, and I'll catch you. You ready? One. And the snake was getting closer. Two. And the snake was opening his big jaws, and the poison was dripping from those fangs. Three, and wee Josh ran like a three-legged chicken, jumped into his daddy's arms. Daddy caught him, and he came running up the road. And the snake, meanwhile, was hanging so far out of the tree that it fell in a big sort of a clump of look. Pretty good sound effects. And boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, wee Josh was saved because he did exactly what his father told him. We have a Father in heaven. God loves us very much. He wants us to be saved from our sins. And he tells us how that can happen by trusting in Jesus. He tells us in the Bible. And if we do exactly what God, our Heavenly Father, says, then we'll be saved too for all eternity. This is really good news. It's something we celebrate. It's why we love to come to church. It's why we love to sing and pray together. We're going to sing another one now. And you did quite well with the sound effects there. Not bad. So we'll see how you do with this one, because we have a little bit of arm action in this one, okay? I'll explain as we go. So this song, it's a kind of a goldie oldie. It's called Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, For the Bible Tells Me So. And when we sing this sometimes with a school class, in primary school, what we do is we say to the boys and girls, we say, now, who would like a lollipop? And what happens? Well, all the hands go up. Everybody puts their hands and say, me. And who would like a night off homework? Me. Right? So who does Jesus love? Let me see. Who does Jesus love? Nobody in the gallery, obviously. Oh, one or two. In the hall, I hope the hands are up. I can't see you. But okay. Who does Jesus love? Me. So when we come to the chorus, on the word me, that's what we do. At least one hand, two if you're able, by all means. But who does Jesus love? Me, he loves us all. Here we go. I should warn you, this is the country and western line dancing version of the hymn. So just be ready for that. Keep your seats all right. You can tap your foot surreptitiously if you must, but here we go. Two, three. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible.
Yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so.
turn to the New Testament, shall we? We're going to read from the Gospel according to Mark. Mark chapter 10, and just a few verses. Verse 13, this is God's word. Some people brought children, little children, to Jesus for him to place his hands on them and bless them. But the disciples scolded the people. When Jesus noticed this, he was angry and said to his disciples, "Let the little children come to me and do not stop them, because the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. I assure you that whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." And then he took the children in his arms, placed his hands on each of them, and blessed them. Amen. May God bless his word to us here in Cairncastle today. Do you ever wonder why was the Lord Jesus so positive about little preschool children? "The kingdom of God belongs to such as these," he said. "Anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." Why are toddlers so important to the Lord Jesus? Today's reading gives me the opportunity to repeat a favorite story of mine. It happened rather a long time ago when I was a student in Belfast. One day I was walking home from the bus and I came across two children standing by some metal railings at the side of a really busy road. And the older one, she was about 9 or 10 years old, she was trying to persuade the younger one, who was about 3, to come home. Now the little one, it seems, had run off in a temper tantrum and got herself lost beside this busy road. And now she was absolutely terrified and she was clinging on to these metal railings with both hands and refusing to budge. Now, I didn't know these children. None of my business. I didn't have any younger siblings. I didn't really have any experience of working with young children or anything. But something made me stop to see if I could help. And so I just sat down in the pavement beside them and started to chat away. And after a few minutes, the little one turned around and dried her eyes. Whereupon I said, "Let's go and find Mummy." That always seems like such a good idea, doesn't it? "Let's go find Mummy." And so we set off. Now you've got to try and picture this. It's quite a wide pavement. I was on the outside next to traffic. The older girl was on the inside. And the little one was in the middle, walking down the pavement side by side. And that's when it happened. As we walked along, I felt a little hand take hold of mine. Now, this little child had never met me before. She didn't know who I was. She didn't have the vocabulary to express faith. But that little hand was saying it all. In her heart, she had decided I was a safe bet, someone she could trust. And within a few moments, they were home safe. Now, I never saw them again, but I've always been grateful for the opportunity I had that day just to help those girls, and of the wonderful illustration it gave me of childlike faith, the kind of faith that Jesus values so highly. With this picture in mind, let me suggest several things about Christian faith, and the first is very simple, but absolutely vital. A Christian is someone who trusts in a Savior. This little child was now safe. Yes, she had made some bad decisions. She had got herself lost and vulnerable in a world that was way too big and scary for her to face or try to fix. She needed help. She needed rescue. This is true, spiritual, of every human being in the world, whatever age we are. The Bible says we have all sinned and turned away from God. Some of our choices have led us into disobedience and trouble. Why sometimes people these days make a joke of it. They laugh about sin. This is deadly serious in the Bible. We are in real danger. We stand guilty before a holy God, inviting his righteous anger and punishment rather than his blessing. But he still loves us. So much he gave his only begotten Son to rescue us. And God's word teaches that when we are prepared to humble ourselves, when we are prepared to admit we're lost and that we need rescuing, if we're prepared to trust in the rescuer, Jesus, then we're forgiven. We are saved. A second thing, essential, just every bit as much as the first, is that a Christian is willing to be guided. Not just to trust in the Savior, but willing to follow the Savior. And a little child often needs led carefully in ways that are safe and good. We have four of a family, two boys and two girls. They're all grown up now, they're all in their 20s. But well, we remember when they were little, preschoolers, and you literally at times had to say, no, no, not that way, darling, Bernie, come on, come this way. And sometimes parents, good parents, have got to do that. We have to gently but firmly lead our little ones in the right way. Now, the question for us as adults or as older young people, are we willing to be led by Jesus? Not just will we say, I trust in him and hopefully I'll go to heaven someday, but am I willing to follow him as one of his disciples every day? You see, Jesus sends the Holy Spirit to live in and among his followers, to lead us in paths of righteousness and truth. His ways will sometimes lead us contrary to the fashions of this world. Are we up for that challenge? Are we prepared to follow Jesus even if some of our friends or work associates are going in a very different way? Even if it brings us some antagonism, even hostility? In the end of the day, it's really not an option. Jesus said, if we love him, we will obey his commands. The evidence that our faith is real is our desire to obey and honor our Savior first and foremost. Now, one of the lovely things about being a Christian is we don't have to do it alone. He gives us each other. The beauty of church is we are a family in Christ, all sorts of various personalities and gifts, but we are united. We belong together in him. And more than ever in these very difficult times during this corona thing and the uncertainty of how long it's going to go on and how things will change in the future, we need to be family. We need to be a caring fellowship. Now, we can't have tea and scones today. We're really quite disappointed about that. We can't even shake hands at the door, and that's so counterintuitive because we like to be warm and friendly. Of course we do. What can we do? What can we do to express that we are still family, that we are still fellowship? Could you lift the phone? Maybe ring someone that you know is on their own, might be vulnerable. Hi, I hope you don't mind that. Just thinking about you. Hope you're okay. Everything all right? Anything I can do for you? We could write a letter. That's really old-fashioned, isn't it? We could actually write a letter, or we could send an email.
We could even take out our smartphones and maybe dash off something on WhatsApp, but we could express concern, we could express our love in lots of different ways. Over the last months, I've been praying with some of my parishioners through open windows, sometimes in gardens, sometimes out in the middle of farmyards. It's been quite interesting. Something I would really relish, if this is the will of God, would be to get to know you people here in Cairncastle, and as restrictions hopefully ease, work with you in reaching out to people, members of the congregation and beyond, with the hope and the inspiration that is in Jesus in this often lonely and confusing 21st century. Now, there's one more thought here about faith, about childlike faith. Trusting in Jesus Christ. Remember that story I told at the beginning? Trusting in Jesus Christ as Son of God and Savior means we're on our way home. That little child still had much to learn about the world, but she wasn't worried. She was saved, she was being guided and protected, and she was going home. That's all that mattered. She was content. Now, as we grow up, as we go through life, at every stage, there are many opportunities to be enjoyed with gratitude. There's also many challenges to be faced. Obstacles to be overcome, heartaches to be endured. It's certainly not all easy in the short term. But Christians have been shown the last page. Do you ever get a book and you read the first chapter? You say, am I going to read this whole thing? You know, you're on holiday and you're there by the pool and you say, 586 pages. So you turn to the back pages. Is there a happy ending? Well, we can do that. And the back page of the Bible is wonderful. It's New Jerusalem, new heavens, new earth, the home of righteousness. We've been shown the last page. We've been given to know the end of the story, and it's good, and it's safe in God's loving hands. And we're told that one day the Lord Jesus will return in glory, and God will make all things new. There'll be no more sin or evil, no more war or grief or death or sorrow or pain, no more of the things that spoil it for now. Those who have trusted and followed Jesus in this present imperfect age will get to live with him in heavenly peace. Even now, he is preparing a place for us, an eternal home in the Father's house. Our reward is waiting. Our calling for now is to be faithful to the one who gave his life to rescue us. Didn't cost me much that day to help those children. Just a few minutes of my time. But it cost Jesus everything on the day they nailed him to the cross outside of Jerusalem. But he endured that out of love for us. Risen, glorified today, he invites us to put our trust in him like little children. Christians, we're not any better than anybody else. We're just grateful people, thankful people who have trusted Jesus for salvation. We're following, trying to follow and obey him day by day. We're doing it together through this life. We're living in anticipation of one day being at home with him in heaven. Praise his wonderful name. Let's pray, shall we? Almighty God, our Father in heaven, thank you so much for your word. Thank you that this is not at all difficult to understand. Perhaps at times we make things more complicated than they need to be. Perhaps we are complicated. But thank you that you love us so much you gave your son. And thank you that those who trust in Jesus have all that help of heaven to work things out in the here and now. that we might one day be together with you in heaven. So, dear Lord, clear away all the clouds of doubt and disobedience and silliness that we put in the way, the obstacles we throw up. And, dear Lord, shine the light of your love into our minds and our hearts and our very souls now, that we might gladly, thankfully, come running to Jesus. Dear Lord, hear us in our prayers today as we pray for the ongoing situation. We haven't had a coronavirus before. We don't really know how to get through this. But we do pray for ourselves and our families and our neighbours that we would be responsible and careful, that you would help us to overcome our natural fear and anxiety. Dear Lord, that you would bless our governments, the Assembly of Stormont and Dáil Éireann as well in the south and Westminster. Dear Lord, those with responsibility to try and guide us and help us and provide for us through these challenging times. We pray again, of course, for our health workers, doctors and nurses, all those frontline people who are risking and working so hard. Bless them, Lord, in their ministry. We pray, dear Lord, for those who are sorrowing just now, for those perhaps who have lost a loved one, and with the restrictions, how difficult it is for us even to meet together and comfort one another. Dear Lord, be our refuge and strength. We're asked to remember today the Near East School of Theology in Beirut, which was damaged in the recent explosion, and also Jordan Evangelical Theological Seminary. These colleges that are training ministers to work in the Middle East and in North Africa. Dear Lord, we pray that you would help them through all their challenges. We pray that you would fill these young men and women with your Holy Spirit to serve you, and to serve you powerfully. And may your church be built, and may your kingdom continue to come there and here and everywhere throughout your world. Hear these and all our prayers, which we offer you now, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing again. We're going to sing "In Christ Alone, My Hope Is Found." stand together, shall we, for our closing prayers. Dear Lord Jesus, will you accept the gifts that will be given just now, but more, will you accept us, our hearts, our lives, as we offer them now in your service in this place. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.